On July 17, 2008, agents from the Pennsylvania SPCA executed a search warrant at Limestone Kennel, a state-licensed dog breeding kennel deep in rural Chester County.
The day we arrived with the warrant, it was hot. It was humid. I'd say it was definitely into the 90s. And there's just chaos, a lot of people, a lot of dogs, just a very tense atmosphere to work in.
The first step was to deal with the kennel owner, Farmer John Blank.
When he saw us come on the property, he was extremely, extremely upset. And I think at that point he knew that he was in trouble.
Blank had nearly 90 dogs confined in squalid cages to breed.
A lot of the dogs, the floors were wire, a lot of the animals, their paws were going through the floor. A lot of the animals were sick. Some were actually open, had real open wounds and were literally bleeding through the wire floor and onto the floor. It was a mess. The kennel was really a mess.
What the PSPCA had found was a puppy mill.
Traditionally, a puppy mill was any place that mass-produced dogs for resale in pet stores. And over the years, because the conditions at most of these places are so bad, it has come to apply to any bad breeder.
Bob Baker filmed this undercover footage. Over more than a quarter of a century, he has visited upwards of 1,000 large-scale commercial breeding kennels, often discovering shockingly bad standards.
The breeders consider their dogs as nothing other than puppy-producing machines. They're there to turn a profit for them. They're just bred incessantly in horrendous conditions, and as soon as they don't come into heat regularly, they take them out and shoot them. They're disposable.
Limestone Kennel was a substandard large-scale breeder, like many of the places Bob Baker has spent his life investigating. The PSPCA raid at the kennel removed a total of 88 dogs. It was a massive operation, yet it all began with a seemingly insignificant newspaper ad. The ad caught the eye of Bill Smith, who runs a nonprofit that rescues animals and campaigns against puppy mills.
Mr. Blank had placed an ad in one of the local newspapers. He was trying to give up breeding dogs that could no longer breed. So we played telephone tag for about 2 weeks. We went back and forth, and finally we just drove down there, and over the course of 3 days we were able to rescue 10 dogs. Yellow Lab had an ear cut off. One poor dog, a little Shiba Inu, couldn't close his mouth because his teeth were in such bad shape they looked like nails sticking out in all directions. They were missing hair, they were underweight, they couldn't walk properly.
Smith took 9 of Blank's dogs to the Pennsylvania SPCA so their vets could see if there was enough evidence to pursue a case against the kennel.
So you can see his teeth are basically rotting out of his head.
Dr. Rachel Lee found some of the problems characteristic of puppy mill dogs.
This is just pure neglect. Nobody could look at this dog and not realize that there's something wrong with his mouth.
The real tragedy is what you see in the breeding stock. These dogs that are burnt out, I mean, some of them are just in horrific, horrific shape when they come out of these puppy mills. They have a whole host of diseases, and mange, and dehydrated, and malnourished, and losing their hair, it's pathetic.
The condition of the dogs from Blank's kennel demanded urgent investigation. And the downfall of Limestone Kennel came one step closer when Officer Ashley Mutch went in undercover.
For now, I am an assistant manager with a pet shop. My main goal is to just talk money with them. You know, if I can say, don't give those away for free even though they're sick, I'll take them, I'll give you $25 a puppy, and you know, you'll be making some money on these ones that no one else would really want to buy from you. By then, I can get the sick ones out and get them evaluated, and then that should be enough for a warrant. When I first arrived at the farm,
I parked my car in front of the house. I didn't see anybody. So I got out, walked around, yelled for people to maybe notice me or come out. I didn't see anybody. Hello? I heard the dogs barking, so I went down into the back area where they were, and I just saw the whole area full of dogs and hutches. I went in and out of the rows of hutches a couple times, and then I started to get a little nervous because I don't want people to find me poking around their property.
Before Mutch could locate the farmer, he found her.
He was extremely irate. He didn't know what I was doing. I couldn't really hear him because the dogs were barking so loudly. I explained to him why I was there.
Here, I'm here about some puppies.
And the whole issue that came up was money. I'm here to buy wholesale. You know, I'll make money, you'll make money. Listen, I'm here to work with you. We can do some business. While we were looking through, I noticed one that looked like it was dead.
What about this one right here?
I looked a little bit closer, and I pointed at that one, and I realized it was still breathing. So I asked him if he would sell that one to me, and he made the comment, you know, why would you want that one? It's probably dead, or it's gonna die in about 10 minutes. And I said, that's what I'm here to do business for. I said, we take these. At least if it dies, I lose $30, but if it makes it, I'll make $300. I flashed him $30, and he took it, put it in my bag, and I left.
Officer Mutch had accomplished her mission of getting a good look at conditions at the kennel, but her immediate priority was saving the life of the puppy she'd bought. The rural tranquility of John Blank's limestone kennel in Chester County, Pennsylvania, masked a disturbing reality. Officer Ashley Mutch went in undercover to investigate and bought a sick Yorkie poo from Blank. She rushed the Yorkie poo back to the PSPCA in Philadelphia, where the veterinary team battled to keep the puppy alive. Her condition was the final piece of evidence that sealed the fate of Limestone Kennel.
She was just laying on the bottom of the wire. Okay.
The Yorkie Poo was one of an estimated 2.7 million puppies born every year in what the Humane Society of the United States describes as puppy mills.
We estimate at any given time there are about 10,000 puppy mills operating in the United States. Our estimates of the industry are that we think it does probably hit that billion-dollar mark. It's a huge industry with thousands of producers. It really is a massive industry in this country.
Give me the exam gloves. Sorry about that.
Sadly, the tiny puppy passed away the next day. But for three female chocolate Labradors, rescued earlier by Bill Smith from the same kennel, the rehabilitation process can begin. Saturn, Sally, and Tara all have defective left eyes that need a specialist's opinion. It's Saturn's turn first. But after a lifetime standing on wire in her cage, she finds a solid floor frightening. Eye specialist Dr. Stephen Gross examines her missing eye.
There's a good chance that this is all due to a birth defect.
Okay.
Her eyelids, if you look at this eyelid, how abnormally shaped it is there.
The vets can't be certain, but it seems likely that the careless breeding often practiced in puppy mills has played a part.
You have dogs with eye problems, deafness, a lot of genetic defects, hip dysplasia, luxating patellas, you name it, and these dogs are going to have it. Because they're not selecting the breed stock, again, on the best disposition or temperament or genetics or pedigree. They're looking for the cheapest dog available that will produce puppies, nothing else.
Sally and Tara's eye problems may be genetic, too. All three dogs will be scheduled for surgery soon to treat their eyes.
There we go. Come on.
Limestone Kennel was part of a complex industry that is, in theory, closely regulated. Large-scale commercial kennels sometimes sell puppies direct to pet stores, but usually they sell to a broker who sells on to a pet store. Kennels that sell wholesale like this are subject to the Federal Animal Welfare Act and are licensed and inspected by the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
The USDA requirements are bare minimum, and in fact the law even states the word minimum requirements. And so just basic food and water, supposed to be clean and supposed to give them comfort from the bad weather, extremes of temperature. But that's basically it. I refer to those standards as survival standards. If you follow USDA standards, will a dog survive? Probably, yes. But is it humane? Absolutely not.
The Pennsylvania Professional Dog Breeders Association represents around 500 kennels, the majority being large commercial breeding facilities. These photographs show some of the association members' USDA licensed kennels and conditions they regard as good. Breeding dogs this way is completely legal. But critics argue that even the best run facilities are unacceptable, let alone the ones that are substandard.
It's like comparing a dirty prison to a clean prison or a well-run prison. It's still a prison. The dogs are still in a prison.
You're talking about housing dogs in cages that are no more than 6 inches longer than they are.
That's the amount of space that these animals are allowed.
They have these wire flooring with the hopes that the excrement will fall through the wire and they never have to clean the cages. But the fact of the matter is, it doesn't fall through, so it's a mess. Even when you follow USDA guidelines, you're just talking about just bare minimum standards.
The challenge really here comes down to the point that just because it's legal doesn't mean it's okay.
We invited the Pennsylvania Professional Dog Breeders Association to comment. They said, the Animal Welfare Act is based on science and verifiable facts in regulating the care for all animals. It addresses the different standards and husbandry techniques needed for different species. Many animal rights activists feel that no animals should be bred or confined. They added that John Blank was not a member of their association and said, we strongly believe in the welfare, humane treatment, and quality husbandry care for all animals. We feel that any breeder not sharing these beliefs should not be raising puppies. John Blank's kennel had a USDA license during 2007, but he let it lapse. At the time of the PSPCA raid, it's thought that he was selling direct to the public, for example, on the internet. Kennels that sell direct in this way are only subject to state laws where they exist. In Pennsylvania, it meant that Blank was subject to licensing and inspection by the Bureau of Dog Law Enforcement, part of the State Department of Agriculture. Up in Chester County, the PSPCA and Bureau of Dog Law Enforcement have joined forces. Assistant DA Lorraine Finnegan has been handling the case against John Blank.
The disposition was 8 guilty pleas on animal cruelty charges. He pled to them as summary offenses, and each of those offenses had 90 days probation, each running consecutive for a total of 2 years of probation.
In the wake of the PSPCA's raid, the owner was also cited and fined by the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture.
The combination of those two agencies has led to a revocation of a kennel license, and the kennel's going to be closed. As of today, there's no kennel at Limestone.
The legal case may be done, but it's clear the dogs removed from Limestone Kennel are just beginning the road to recovery. Tara is about to have her bulging eye removed by Dr. Lori Carbell.
The eye is definitely, is completely, it's got glaucoma. I think it's not visual, and given the risk that it could block and become large, it probably should just come out, make her more comfortable.
The operation will be delicate, but at last, Tara will be getting expert treatment. Meanwhile, at Mainline Animal Rescue, Sally, Tara's former kennel mate, is spending time with Bill Smith.
What's going here?
This is a typical puppy mill dog. They're absolutely terrified because they've never been handled by people. Not in a nice way. This is what she does all day long until she exhausts herself, and then she plops down all day long because that's all she did while she was in the hutch. Okay, baby.
Time is a great healer for puppy mill dogs, and Bill will give Sally all the time she needs.
I know, you're a good girl. God, isn't she great? Look at this face.
Back in surgery, Dr. Lori Carbell is pleased with how things have gone.
See her back in 10 to 14 days for sutures to be removed, and if all looks good then, she's should be resolved and fine to be adopted.
Pennsylvania is sometimes described as the puppy mill capital of the East. On October 1st, 2008, the PSPCA raided Almost Heaven, a large-scale commercial dog breeding kennel in Lehigh County, north of Philadelphia. It was home to nearly 600 dogs and a number of other animals. The raid followed months of undercover investigation. Dogs removed from the kennel were photographed back at the PSPCA. Their condition, testimony to what the agent saw.
The place was totally filthy inside. The runs, a lot of them looked like they hadn't been cleaned in weeks, in some cases months. A lot of the animals were sick. Some of them were injured.
Disturbingly, just 8 weeks earlier, the kennel had been inspected by the Pennsylvania Bureau of Dog Law Enforcement and had been given the seal of approval. It was only after the PSPCA raid that the Bureau revoked the kennel license for 2008. For Howard Nelson, it was another example of a recurring issue.
Many kennels, including Limestone and Almost Heaven, that we raided with the Pennsylvania SPCA received high marks from the Bureau of Dog Law and the wardens who investigated them year after year, and there's no question those kennels were not acceptable.
It's not the first time the Bureau's operations have been called into question. In 2007, journalist Tim Darrell undertook a detailed investigation of the Bureau's records from 2003 through 2006 and made some startling discoveries. He began by analyzing large numbers of kennel inspection reports.
Perhaps the most significant finding that we had was that the inspections were coming back perfect, better than 90% of the time. And in any human endeavor where you're dealing with things that move and circumstances that change, better than 90% is an impossible target.
Dara also discovered flaws in the Bureau's computer system. It wasn't saving all the kennel inspection data that was entered, and there was worse to come.
The way the state set up the program, it defaulted straight to satisfactory, unless someone changed it. That almost never happened.
The computer system has been updated, and critics acknowledge other improvements in the Bureau's performance, but they claim serious problems remain.
We're seeing that they are citing more for lack of sanitation, they're citing more for a lack of adequate shelter, but dogs are still suffering. Lack of veterinary care is the biggest problem in puppy mills. They're nothing but building inspectors.
Bill Smith agrees. After removing the chocolate Labradors with the eye problems from John Blank's Limestone Kennel, he checked through some old inspection reports and found an intriguing detail.
We noticed that the inspector made a note at the bottom of the inspection report. This is exactly what she wrote. Note, eyes on chocolate labs. And that was back in 2003. And the dogs, John Blank told us that the dogs had been there for 6, 7, 8 years. So they were in that facility for 5 years while these inspectors walked by them twice a year and didn't do anything.
Bob Baker argues the wardens must do more.
You know, we're hearing stories, well, the wardens don't like to cite for lack of vet care. You know, I don't care what the wardens like to do or don't like to do. This is their job, and they better bloody well do it. I mean, these dogs are suffering out there.
The Bureau of Dog Law Enforcement declined to be interviewed for this program, but stated that following an investigation into the Limestone Kennel case, one former supervisor has been transferred to other duties. In the meantime, the State Inspector General's office is conducting an independent investigation into the Bureau's handling of the Almost Heaven Kennel case. Although the kennel's 2008 license was not reinstated, the latest inspection report does indicate a massive improvement in conditions at Almost Heaven. However, the owner faces 12 counts of animal cruelty, including unsanitary conditions and lack of veterinary care. He has not yet entered his pleas and awaits his day in court. The cases at Limestone and Almost Heaven Kennels highlighted disturbing flaws in the enforcement of Pennsylvania's dog laws. But at least in Pennsylvania, there is a system that should protect dogs. 1,200 miles away in Nashville, Tennessee, there isn't even a proper system. Tennessee is one of 30 states in the U.S. where commercial breeders can use loopholes in the law to sell direct to the public. without any inspection of their kennels. It leaves dogs and puppies at the mercy of kennel owners. 50 miles from Nashville, deep in the woods of Hickman County, Patricia Atkinson operated Pine Bluff Kennel. She had nearly 700 dogs, seven times as many as Limestone Kennel in Pennsylvania. By summer 2008, she had only one permanent employee who cared for the adult dogs, while Atkinson was supposed to be responsible for the mothers and puppies in the so-called puppy house. But Atkinson's employee was deeply distressed by what she saw in the puppy house. Her identity is concealed for her safety.
When I go into the puppy house and I had two-week-old Boston puppies walking around in 2 inches of their feces and no water, no food, and dead puppies, that's when I knew that this wasn't supposed to happen. This was disgusting.
By summer 2008, conditions at Pine Bluff Kennel in rural Hickman County, Tennessee, had become desperate. Photographs were sent secretly to Leanne McCollum, Tennessee Director of the Humane Society of the United States.
When I opened those pictures and I saw these two-week-old Boston Terrier puppies literally stuck in feces up to their bellies and they couldn't move, and puppies that were crowded inside an empty food bowl just so they didn't have to stand in the inches of feces that were in their kennel. It was just that gut reaction and tearing up and wanting to rush in and save them today.
But McCollum knew she had to take the long view in order to help all the dogs at Pine Bluff. She called in the authorities. The district attorney general assigned criminal investigator Barry Carroll to the case. Pine Bluff Kennel was already known in the area because the owner, Patricia Atkinson, had been convicted of 3 counts of animal cruelty in 2000. But the search at her property, which yielded evidence leading to the convictions, had violated constitutional principles. As a result, her convictions were reversed on appeal in 2001. Now, there was another chance to seek justice.
That's where Pat lives. Pat Atkinson.
Over a period of a month, Carroll worked covertly with an informant from the kennel. He needed her to gather more photos and other evidence.
Hello?
She had to be very careful. She was very careful not to get caught in the puppy house or taking photographs, period. She was in fear of getting, exposed or found out.
I was worried I was going to blow the whole case. That the evidence that I had collected wouldn't have been worth anything if she had caught me in there.
I asked her one day, why are you doing this? And she said that she wanted to see every dog on that place. She wanted them to know what it was like to be loved and to sit in somebody's lap and to be held and petted and to know what it was like to be loved, to feel love for just a little bit. And that was good for me. That was enough.
Eventually, Carroll had enough evidence for a search warrant. The Humane Society of the United States, working with the ASPCA and many other agencies, began to plan the logistics of removing hundreds of animals from the property. When law enforcement arrived at Pine Bluff, Patricia Atkinson offered no resistance and immediately agreed to surrender all her animals. The huge team coordinated by the Humane Society could get to work.
And her side door's not locked there.
The adult dogs were kept in numerous areas of the property, which covered nearly 100 acres. But the most shocking sight was the puppy house.
This is the worst of it here. You got a couple hundred dogs in here and puppies as well.
Once we got into the trailer, that's when my heart sunk. those were amongst the worst conditions we have seen. I'd say only 10% of the dogs in that room had water. Any food that was in that room was rotten. There were dead puppies in the cage with living mothers and other sibling puppies. Just absolute squalid conditions. It doesn't look like anybody had touched that room in weeks.
I've been in law enforcement for 25 years. And I've worked a lot of homicides, a lot of suicides, a lot of deaths. I've seen a lot of things, but I have never seen anything quite like this.
Each animal had to be documented, and veterinary and forensic specialists treated them and gathered evidence.
It's okay.
682 dogs and 65 other animals were removed from Pine Bluff and went to new homes across the U.S. In the meantime, the case against Patricia Atkinson was building.
Patricia Atkinson is facing 24 counts of aggravated animal cruelty. And what the indictment alleges is that there were 24 separate animals that were involved that were deprived of care, most likely food and water, to the extent that they were seriously injured or facing near death. There are nine additional counts alleged against Patricia Atkinson of animal cruelty, which basically alleges she failed to provide normal care for those animals. And again, there are nine separate animals that are cited in those counts.
Pine Bluff Kennel is closed, and Patricia Atkinson no longer lives at the property. She has pled not guilty to the charges and awaits trial. If she's convicted, she could face lengthy jail time. There are plans for new laws in Tennessee and federally to regulate kennels that sell direct to the public, like Pine Bluff did. But it may be some time before those plans become law. Whatever happens, over 700 animals have gone on to better lives. Cricket, a young German shepherd, is just one of them. She now lives in a forever home with Barbara Harris in Nashville. It's the result the informant hoped for.
I'm happy about what happened. I'd do it again, and I wake up every day and I think about it, and I think about all the animals that I saved, and know that there's one less puppy mill. I wanted them to know what it was like, you know, to be loved and to be warm in the winter, and to, you know, sit and watch TV on a couch with somebody, and, you know, to sleep in somebody's bed with them at night. You know, that's what they deserve.
In Miami, nearly 1,000 miles away, another young dog knows what it's like to be loved and cherished. Nugget, the mini Sheltie, was bought from a seemingly upscale pet store with the best intentions.
People go into a pet store and they think by paying these huge prices that they're paying for this dog that they're getting another Rin Tin Tin or Lassie. And what they don't realize is they're getting the cheapest dog that's available on the market and probably very likely to be sick and ill.
In the beginning, it was a nightmare. There were days that I cried and thinking, oh my God, what did I do?
Nugget's owner learned the hard way that buying a pet store puppy can be the road to heartache.
Thank you.
Although it's not doing anything illegal, this pet store in the suburbs of Philadelphia is the target of a weekly demonstration. The protesters are trying to make the public think about where pet store puppies come from. It's estimated that there are some 3,500 pet stores in the U.S. that sell puppies. And it's thought that virtually all of them come from large-scale commercial breeders. But it's extremely difficult for customers to determine the standards in the kennels that supply the stores.
You know, and pet stores like to say that we don't get our dogs at puppy mills. But the fact of the matter is, who else sells to pet stores? A responsible breeder would never sell a puppy to a pet store.
They can rightfully claim we don't buy from puppy mills if, in fact, they're buying directly from brokers, because that, in fact, is a true statement. They're not buying directly from the puppy mills. They're buying from the brokers who buy from the puppy mills.
Uncovering the puppy supply chain requires tenacity, but it was exactly what Jeff Burnside of NBC6 News in Miami managed to do. the investigative reporter fronted an award-winning series of reports that aired in 2006. Jeff and his producer were hearing bad things about a local pet store called Wizard of Claws, run by Jim and Gilda Anderson. It sold puppies from the store and also right across the U.S., thanks to its glamorous-looking website. But it didn't take the journalists long to trace 160 dissatisfied customers nationwide, most with sick dogs.
And a stand-up here, backers.
Pneumonia, a heart murmur, massive fatal hemorrhaging, a collapsed lung, dogs unfit for sale.
What really got our attention was that on his website and in our undercover work was really promoting the fact that his dogs were the best of the best. That's his quote. That he knew where all these dogs came from. He had a long-term relationship with the people who were raising these dogs.
Shirley Pass's experience of buying her mini Sheltie Nugget from Wizard of Claws was remarkably similar.
Well, what they did was they told me that where she came from a reputable breeder. I thought, okay, these people seem to be on the up and up. You know, they had all their paperwork. And so I went ahead and took them at their word.
Shirley bought Nugget, and then the problems began.
Well, when I brought Nugget home, she had blood in her stool. And she also had diarrhea. So I was thinking, wait a minute, something's wrong with this. This shouldn't be happening.
Shirley took Nugget to Wizard of Claws' vet, but the problems continued. Eventually, her own vet diagnosed Giardia, a parasite.
The vet told me that the consequences of having such an intense infection that she could end up having digestive problems, any amount of things, be on medication for the rest of her life, be on a special diet. So needless to say, she is on a special diet and can only eat a certain type of food and nothing else.
After her experience, Shirley wanted answers from Wizard of Claws.
They gave me excuse after excuse. They were going to call me back. They never called me back. And it was just very frustrating dealing with them.
We wanted to know if there were
NBC6's Jeff Burnside was able to make more progress than Shirley. He established that Jim Anderson is an ex-felon and was fined for violating federal animal welfare law. Then, Jeff started investigating where Wizard of Claws' expensive puppies really came from.
We traced dog after dog that Anderson purchased on internet auctions, sort of an eBay for dogs.
Then we went and looked at the USDA inspection reports for some of these puppy mills from whom he was buying his dogs, and we quickly determined that they were not the quality breeders that he was claiming to buy from.
The next step for Jeff and his co-workers was to go undercover.
Good afternoon, I'm Jeff Burnside, live in the NBC.
They filmed two of the kennels in the Midwest, which supplied the brokers that supplied some of Wizard of Claws' dogs.
We traced 50 of Anderson's purchases to here, including these dogs that later became sick and one died.
Having traced the connection between the kennels and Wizard of Claws, Jeff challenged Anderson.
Isn't it a fact that you are buying dogs from puppy mills?
It's not with my belief, no.
But you're implying to your customers you do know where your dogs are coming from.
I'm not applying to all my customers. Most customers don't really ask, or they don't really care.
Even when we showed him video of the puppy mills from whom he bought, he still claimed that that was an exception and that his other suppliers were top-notch.
After Jeff's reports aired in 2006, Wizard of Claws attorney said the business had disassociated itself and no longer did business with the breeders filmed by Burnside. But the reports made more unhappy customers get in contact, bringing the total to 275. The Florida Attorney General became involved.
People love their animals. And so,
and he is now pursuing a lawsuit against Jim and Gilda Anderson for deceptive and unfair trade practices. Around 100 dissatisfied customers are also involved in a class action against Wizard of Claws, and Shirley Pass is one of them. For Jeff Burnside, the repercussions of his reports have been much closer to home.
We ended the series by saying, if you want to get a dog and you don't want to get it from a pet store, then go to the shelter. That's where they all are. While I was at the shelter doing that story, it dawned on us that really I should be putting my money where my mouth is. And then ran across this little guy here, and we named her Pearl. And she was like so many other animals in the shelters. Couldn't find a home. Couldn't find anybody who wanted her.
Spin around. Spin around. Spin around. Good.
This is really the symbol of all the effort we put into exposing this horrific pipeline from puppy mills to pet stores. It's Pearl.
Pearl was just one of millions of dogs who needed a home. And animal welfare organizations encourage the public to adopt rather than buy. They say it avoids the risk that a pet store or online purchase will help keep a puppy mill in business, as well as giving a needy dog a home.
I think the real irony in this whole situation is that there's 2.5 million dogs a year being euthanized in this country because there are not enough good homes. And at the same time these animals are being killed, the puppy mill industry is churning out hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dogs to be marketed in the pet store. I mean, if people want a loving pet, all they need to do is go to their animal shelter.